Look at a period when the Muslims had established the Khalifa. That the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ had been dead for almost 100 years. Now the Islam was beginning to spread throughout the world. Look at a time when the Muslims were entering into a country where there were no other Muslims. That there was established religions. One of these religions persecuting the other Akhavi-Tabi religion. Look at a time when the Ummah of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ was an Ummah that was a reflection of every color and nationality, just like we have in this room tonight. Look at a time when those Muslims came together, not just as Arabs, not just as people from the subcontinent, not just as Europeans, not just from North Africa or West Africa. Look at a time when Tariq ibn Ziyad, in 711 of the Common Era, went into the southern part of Spain and established a caliphate, helped to bring about the establishment of Islam in Europe. Look at this time. Look at what was going on with the Ummah. Look at how those from the Arabian Peninsula, now that Islam has spread into North Africa, into West Africa, that the Muslims are getting strong all over the earth. Look at this time when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helped to bring these Muslims together to bring Islam into Europe. And for almost the next 1,000 years, to be more exact, 800 years, the Muslims were the light of the world. The Muslims ruled much of Al-Andalus, this Iberian Peninsula, this country of Spain, for almost 1,000 years. And we can talk about all the beauty, all of the science, all of the astronomy, all of the books. Look at all of what we produced when we came together in a true brotherhood based on necessity, based on the necessity of the moment. That we understood that my being an African-American means nothing based on the necessity of the moment. What do I need to do to lend my African-American self to this Ummah to do what needs to be done? So, in brief, when we look at this history and just glancing over this history, we find that at a certain juncture, some old bad habits began to set into our Ummah. And the bad habits began to cause us to start breaking up and fragmenting. And the bad habits caused us to say, those Africans who are up there in Spain, those Arabs who are up there in Spain, what we have to do, we have to be dominant. We can't have this quilt. Of leadership that we have. Let's go back to our old ways. We're comfortable with that. And read the history of Al-Andalus. I'm not trying to sugarcoat it. Read the history. And you'll find that what we talk about, the glory of Spain over the centuries began to crumble. I had the opportunity in 2004 to visit two of the cities that were part of the crown jewel of the Muslims from the time of 711, when Tariq ibn Ziyad crossed the Strait of Gibraltar, turned around to his men and ordered them to burn the ships, and then said, the sea is at our back, the enemies of Allah are in front of us, now what are you going to do? Look back at that time, and we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us this glorious period, and it unraveled as the interworkings of the Muslims started to go back to tribalism and nationalism. And this beautiful ummah fragmented to the point that when I was in Spain in 2004, praying in the mosque, what I still call and you call the mosque at Cordoba, but really it's a cathedral. Because when the Muslims were expelled out of Spain, these beautiful structures were taken over. And this beautiful mosquito, this beautiful structure in Cordoba was now turned into a cathedral, but just a small portion was now an area that had the same mihrab and some of the columns and things there. And you knew that this was a part of the original mosque. So being overwhelmed by the history that I knew of the area, I said, let me make salat. Let me just offer two salat. And as I make sujood, someone comes and grabs me at the back of my neck and pulls me up off the ground. And coming from the background I come from and the little bit of Islam, I started to hit the dude. What's wrong with you? And he spoke to me in perfect English, telling me no. No salah, no dua. This is a cathedral. If I see you making dua, if you get on your knees again, you will be put out of here and you won't be allowed to come back. That's how far we have sunk. And I submit, there are many reasons, but I submit that part of it was because of how our brothers and sisters dealt with the issue of who they were and what was important. The necessity of the moment, or my nationality, my ethnicity. Brothers and sisters, I only have a few moments left. So let me just take a quick survey. I love to do surveys, Imam Khalil. I love to do them. I really love to do it. Let me do a quick survey. How many of you in this room, just quick show of hands, how many of you in this room plan to make this country, and Allahu Alam, Allah knows best, no, we don't know where we're going to be tomorrow, but right now, sitting here tonight, how many of you plan on making this country your home? Let me just see your hands. The overwhelming majority in the room. Let me tell you a quick story and I'll come to an end. With two more points. Quick story. A very dear brother of mine from India by the name of Aftab. You may know Aftab. He's a sociologist, beautiful brother, beautiful speaker. He told a story one time. I heard him speak. We were up in Canada, I think. And he told a story.